as much as you want to think about what is intelligence, etc., and start talking about specific ways of doing these representations and these measurements. Okay. In particular, this picture is actually very useful. There is one more picture after this in the book called the Decision Theoretic or Utility-Based Agent, which is actually quite, it's actually a more generalization of this picture. In the sense here, you think as if the agent has some goals of achievement, which as if there is a specific state where it suddenly becomes happy and it's trying to reach that goal. But as I mentioned earlier, if indeed the performance is dependent on the sequence of states that you go through, then really it becomes more interesting problem. It's not just a path to a goal, it is a path to a goal which satisfies certain trajectory constraints. It should not be too close to any humans, for example, while reaching the goal. You understand what I'm saying? Things like that. And in fact, there are more interesting models that we can look at, in particular something called Markov relation processes. I'm hoping that I'll have time to look at that. But in just looking at this, this should make sense of the course for you whenever you're lost as to why are you doing a particular topic. So as I said, by now there are discussions we need to represent here, and we need to reason about them here. Okay? This is representation, this is inference. These are algorithms, these are data structures. You really want to think in that way. Okay. The question, of course, is what is the data in the data structures? That's, you know, you can think of, you know, the knowledge representation, the representation about your knowledge about the current state of the world, how the world evolves by itself, what your actions will do, and what your goals themselves are. Okay, you the agent. Okay. And we talk about the representation, and then how, if I give you a particular representation, what algorithms can I use to, for example, go from where I am to a state. For now, assume that the goal is a specific state that you want to reach. That's like a simpler scenario. So the question is, what should be the action I should do right now to eventually reach the goal I want to reach? So for example, suppose I want to reach that particular door, then the question would be, what should be my action, current, immediate action, such that I will reach the door? So for example, if I start walking this way, you would start thinking, what's that doing? Because the goal is that side, right? Okay. So that idea as to which should be the action I should do right now so that I can get to the goal fast is planning, essentially. So in this particular case, I sort of planned a path. Okay, my path probably might be something like walking like this. But if people are sleeping on the aisles, then I might have to take a different aisle. Okay, so the environment does change the specific path that I wind up taking. Now the question, of course, is coming up with this path, among the many, many different paths I can proceed on from here, that involves reasoning. In this particular case, it involves a kind of a search between multiple different paths. And those of you who have done something like 3-10 data structures course and have done a graph search, so for example, in a graph, you know, you have a goal state and your initial state, how do you find a path? That would be a reasoning algorithm. Now you might say, well, if you're doing that, aren't you just giving a fancier name to what I did in 3-10 and calling it intelligence? Sort of true, but it depends on, so ultimately, by the way, irrespective of what I do, it all eventually will be Intel PC instructions. Do you understand what I'm saying? Like, whatever I write would be, in the end, it would be Intel PC instructions. Saying it can't be intelligence because everything just got compiled into Intel PC instructions doesn't make any sense. Do you understand what I'm saying? So the question is, how do you formulate what you want to do into algorithms that you know and love? And as of 3-10, you know some algorithms about graph search. In fact, we will use that. And we learn other kinds of algorithms. Okay. Now, in the case of, so as I said, we will talk about this stuff when we talk about topics like logic as a representation mechanism, probabilistic logic such as Bayes networks as a representation mechanism. That's when we'll, you know, those topics are because of the representation. And then in terms of learning, when if you're talking about learning techniques, then they're essentially trying to learn what goes into each of these pieces. So when you're writing an intelligent agent, it's your agent, you can write the knowledge into the various boxes yourself. But your hope is that you'll write some, and then the agent picks up the rest by its experience. And when it does that, that's learning. Okay, so that's where the learning topics come. And then this part, once I give you knowledge, how do I do inference with that knowledge? How do I use the knowledge to figure out, you know, what's my path to the goal, whatever my goal is? That would be essentially, generally speaking, it's called inference. And inference takes different kinds of forms in certain kinds of representations. The first ones we'll talk about, called atomic representations. It's just search. It just looks suspiciously like graph search from Fitton. Okay, except that we essentially, under certain assumptions about this agent architecture, inference just becomes search. And you know, the trick is understanding what those assumptions are. That's what we wind up doing today, and what I wind up doing up till now, and in the next slide. Okay, and then if you know more, you know, more interesting representations of the world, then you will wind up, so even in search, you can do blind versus informed search, and that's first topics, you know, of this course. So for example, the very first project would be doing blind search as well as A star search, you know, and that's what you do. Now, the other parts, like planning, essentially, you could just say finding the path, you know, in a sequence of states is planning by itself. But, you know, the area of planning is typically concerned with situations where the representations are not atomic, but the state has structure. I'll talk about that in a minute. When the state has structure, then search becomes, you get, the search algorithms can exploit the structure of the state. So in the following sense, suppose I tell you your goal is to become rich and famous. And if the representation is just atomic states, and so you say, imagine the following complete state. Do you think I'm rich and famous in this? I'll say yes. And then here's another state. I think I'm rich and famous in this state. I say yes. And so that's the only thing I tell you. Then these are atomic representations where the goal is a test on the state. If I, on the other hand, the very act of saying rich and famous is essentially saying the final goal has two properties, richness, being rich, and being famous, right? And so I could have a planning algorithm which tries to make me rich, and while keeping me rich, tries to make me famous. And makes me famous first, and while keeping me famous, makes me rich. One is Donald Trump, one is Barack Obama. Yeah, think about that. But so either which way, you are trying to exploit the structure of the state in deciding the path. You know, it becomes, you know, easier to understand as we look at the exact algorithms. But essentially, having the structure of the state makes us do more interesting kinds of reasoning than just what can be seen as graph search. Okay. However, in the end, just as whatever you do, you should always be able to write a assembly language program for any task that you're trying to do. It's just that the other things are more. If the task you're trying to solve has, you know, very nice object-oriented structure, you are much better off writing an object-oriented program as against an assembly language program. Even though object-oriented program eventually becomes an assembly language program. Okay. Similarly, first we'll start understanding search. When we get to something like planning, it is eventually doing search. Except you think in terms of essentially the state properties, and then you leave the search details to become compilation aspects. Okay, so you're going up the chain. Now, so in doing this, in the beginning, to make our life simple, we will assume, but we'll start by assuming that the world is deterministic. That means actions have predictable effects, completely predictable effects. And we'll also assume in the very beginning that the world is static. That means you are the only agent, and the environment stays in the state it is in until you do the next action. Okay? It turns out it's as simple as, you know, representation as it becomes, you know, problem it becomes, and it turns out that from a computational tractability point of view, even in this simplified problems, there are very, very hard, computationally hard problems. Okay? So for example, you guys know Tower of Hanoi, right? Yes, computer science people, you know Tower of Hanoi. Tower of Hanoi is as boring as it gets, right? Is it dynamic? Is Tower of Hanoi dynamic? Are there people moving stuff around when you're not moving? No. Okay? Is it predictable? It is predictable because, you know, with respect of which picture, which story of Tower of Hanoi you believe in, nobody ever says the priests are trying to put these things with shaky hands. So piece that, I don't know if you heard about the Tower of Hanoi backstory. It is the idea that they're trying to shift them according to these rules from one peg to the third peg, And when they succeed, the world will come to an end. They only have 64 pegs they are working with. When they succeed in putting all the 64 pegs in this order, back into this order, by following the rules of the game, the world will come to an end. So it's like a really dangerous situation for us. And yet, it's not dynamic. There's no, priests are not getting into each other's way and trying to, you know, move the things around. And it's completely predictable. You know, if you lift this and you put it in this, it will actually stay there. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so you can actually write this as a simple search problem. And you know, that's a pretty hard problem. Right? You know, 64 pegs, and the reason you are not losing any sleep over it is because even with really fast priests, the world is not in a big danger. Because it needs 2 power 64 search, you know, of the order of 2 power 64. Right? Okay, so it turns out actually that this particular problem, the Hamlet problem, is computationally what's called E-space complete, which is harder than, typically seen to be harder than NP complete. NP complete are supposed to be problems where if I give you the solution, you can check if it is a solution or not in polynomial time. There may be exponential number of solutions, and so if you check each of the solutions, whether or not it's a solution in polynomial time, the total time is still exponential. Okay. However, in the case of Tower of Hanoi, the solution itself involves 2 power 64 moves. So the solution itself actually just checking if the solution is right or wrong takes exponential time. So that in some sense is not in the class NP. It's not non-deterministic polynomial. So it's considered harder. And that is as simple a problem as you can think of. It fits as the simplest problem in this architecture. And you know that it's computationally. Okay. So that's the point. That's why, you know, understanding search is not the main thing. And then of course, then after search, what we do is after search with single agent, a deterministic world, and static world, the first thing we do is allow an additional agent into the world. Okay? That would be game theory search. Okay? And then so we can understand things like chess. But we will do it while still sticking essentially to the representations being atomic. Okay? And then we will go to single agent search back and then look at the propositional representations where, so first we look at representation-wise atomic representation, where states are in some sense indivisible. I mean, if the state has some number, okay, state 59, state 75, okay, the entire thing is one snapshot, that's it. Okay, and your program directly manipulates the states. It takes a state, gives more states. And another test takes a state and says, yes, it's a goal. No, it's not a goal. Okay, search algorithms are written by starting with a state, and there's something called a child generator function, which takes the search and generates children. And then these children are sort of thrown somewhere, and then they're processed one by one. Okay, and when they're processed, the first thing you do when you're picking them up for processing, essentially processing means having their children be looked at. But before looking at their children, this idea of looking at their children involves giving the state to a program which gives the children half the state. Children generator function. It's called expansion. Node expansion or state expansion. And before you expand, you ask a goal test function, which is another opaque piece of code that the program doesn't know how to reason with. It just calls that code that and says, here is your argument, state. Yes, no. And yes means, yes, it's a goal. No means, no, not, it's not a goal. And if it's yes, I stop and declare victory. At which point, I have basically started from some goal, some state, and reached a state which satisfied the goal test. Then if I kept my data structures correct, I would be able to figure out how I got here. I have to put pointers to my parents. Okay, and then you follow your parent pointers and you get the path. That's your search path. And that's your plan, basically. And then you do the first action on that, then the second action, and the third action, and then you reach the goal. Okay, so that is basically search. That's how search algorithms work, and that's what we were looking at. It turns out, if this is as simple as search is, what's the difference between different search algorithms? Every search algorithm takes a state, expands it to get its children, puts them in some data structure, takes them out, checks if they're goals, if not expands them, puts their children in the data structure. What is the avenue for innovation here?
the path they take?
No. The innovation path is how will you put the children in the data structure? It turns out, for example, the data structure can be a queue. That means the very first node was in the queue, you remove it, you take its children, put it in the queue. You take one of the children, take its children, put it back in the queue. So that the siblings get expanded first before the children, after the siblings. That is called breadth first search. Because it kind of goes, if you think of a search tree like this, like that, right? Then you start here, then you go here, 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 you expand these three, then you expand, and so on. Because when you expand this, you will put these two guys at the back of the queue. Because of which, these two guys will still be considered before these two guys. That's breadth first search. Okay? The other option is, if you do queues, you can do something else. What's the other thing that you need in data structures? Stacks. So let's do stacks. Stacks basically, whenever you expand a node, put its children in the front of the queue. That means at the top of the stack. If you're putting anything in the front of the queue, it's not a queue anymore, it's a stack. Okay? So you put it in the top of the stack, and you take it from the top of the stack. That would be, so queues are FIFO, first in, first out. Stacks are LIFO, last in, first out. If you do LIFO, you get a different kind of a search. It's known as depth first search. Now, there it turns out are very interesting computational trade-offs in depth first versus depth first search, which you didn't care as much about when you were in 3.10, because it turns out that you looked at reasonably small graphs in 3.10. You didn't think of graphs that are exponential or double exponential sized. So one of the issues that becomes important when you have large state spaces is how big does the queue become? If the queue becomes very large, you need to put the queue somewhere in the memory, either in the primary or secondary memory. Now, in the breadth first search, you will see that in the end, in the worst case, every node in the final fringe, which will basically be if you have b children for each node in this artificial model, and you go d depth, then there are b power d descendants. There would be a point in the worst case where d power d guys are sitting on the queue. They all need spaces. Do you understand what I'm saying? Right? And the breadth first search will wind up requiring space for all of them. So it requires exponential space. Depth first search, we'll see, actually gets by with b times d. Instead of b power d, b times d. You know, what a huge difference. The placement of D makes. If you shift it a little bit, it B power D. That's huge. B times D is linear memory. Because it's memory, the memory that search algorithm takes is linear in the size of the solution. Because you know, if you have a D solution at the depth of D, then you at most ever need to keep a queue that's only b times d size. Now, both of these, in the worst case, wind up taking exponential amount of time to search. Because eventually, I can put, in this kind of a model, this is what's called a uniform tree model, I can put the goal nodes anywhere here. Okay, now, if you're a depth first guy, you think, if I put the goal node here, that should be very easy. Right, because I expand this, I put these children, pick this guy, put these children, that's the first one I get, and I'm done. But you could have been very unlucky and I put it here. In which case you have to look at the entire tree. So in the worst case, you will wind up doing the power D time for the search process itself. So both breadth first and depth first wind up taking D power D time. But we like depth first, it turns out, because it takes B times D space as against B power D space. But we also don't like depth first, because it turns out that if you start having notions of optimal path, optimal plan, then suppose I say, suppose there are some goals, there's a goal here, there's a goal here, there's a goal here, etc. Okay? Now, if you say the shallower boards are cheaper because it takes fewer number of actions to get to them, then can I ask my search algorithms to find the shallower boards, the shallowest goal first? Breakfast search does it free for you because it just goes level by level by level. So when it finds a goal, it is because there was no goal above it. There may be goals in the same level, but no more goals above it. If there were goals above it, it would have found them. Right? So breakfast search definitely finds you the goals that are shallowest, or the optimal path can be found in terms of the number of levels. Breakfast search will find them. Depth first, on the other hand, does not have this property. Why? Because suppose there is a goal here, and there's a goal somewhere here on the leftmost path. Depth first search will find that first. Right? Okay, what's worse, for the kind of problems we will look at in our scenarios, these, what happens is not only do you have these trees that can be very deep, that means the effective depth of the tree can be very high, it can also be the case that the trees, these are not trees at all, they are graphs, and so you can go back and forth between some set of states. So you can loop. Once you can loop, essentially you can have infinite depth branches. Once you have an infinite depth branch, not only is depth first search not finding the best solution, it may not even stop. So depth first search is our man, our guy. However, it doesn't stop sometimes. And even when it stops, it's not guaranteed to be optimal. The reason we like it is it because it takes less space. So these two ideas basically are called uninformed search strategies. They essentially just look at the structure of the graph as given by the children node generator. So one big thing in these problems is we don't look at the graphs explicitly. I just give you a piece of code which takes a node and generates its children. So the graph is defined implicitly. Okay, and depth first search just basically make calls to this without really thinking about how far they have left to go or any such thing. And they're essentially exponential time processes, algorithms, but you know they have these different trade-offs. And one of the nice things we'll do in the case of uninformed search strategies is, can I have best of both worlds? Can I have the linear memory of depth first search while having the completeness guarantees of depth first search? Okay, so the word that I'm using here is completeness and optimality. Optimality essentially, its completeness is, if there is a solution at some finite depth, will the algorithm actually stop and find it? Okay, and optimality is when it finds a solution, would that be guaranteed to be the optimal in terms of, in this case, the number of levels? Okay, and it turns out depth first provides completeness as well as optimality. Depth first search does not provide either. So then we'll come up with this idea called IDDFS. Depth limited depth first search. Depth limited depth first search. What it does is it puts itself an artificial depth limit and says any node which is deeper than that, I'll assume it has no children. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, so for example, I have a tree and I come and tell you, you know, I'm pretty sure that there are, at least I saw one solution for getting out of this room that requires 25 moves. It's hugely useful information. You know that there is at least one solution that's only 25 moves long. Maybe there are cheaper solutions, but you don't need to go beyond 25. So you put 25 as the depth limit on the tree, then the tree becomes finite. It will not have any infinite branches, and so it will complete. depth first search will complete. Okay, so the moment you depth limited depth first search, the it has the advantages of depth first search, and yet it completes. It has the completeness. That means it will not just hang going on an infinite branch, because there are no infinite branches anymore. Okay, and then I becomes more greedy. I become more greedy and say, can I get both completeness and optimality while doing depth first search? Answer is yes. Okay, how do I do that? I basically start by saying, the artificial depth limit is started there. I'll assume the artificial depth limit in the beginning is just zero, which means the root node, I look at the root node and do a depth first search on that. It's a graph of one node. I do depth first search on it, and if it's goal, I stop. You are like the luckiest person in the search history if your root node is your goal node, right? Then you're done. If not, rather than give up, you increase the depth limit by one. Do depth first search again. If you find a solution, you stop and say, this is optimal. You would be right, because if there was a cheaper solution, you would have found it in the previous iteration. Do you understand what I'm saying? Just one second. So in each iteration, you're still doing depth first search, so you have linear memory. But in no iteration are you doing an infinite tree. Furthermore, you're looking at this tree piece by piece by piece. You're doing some repeated work. That's the cost you pay. You're repeating the work because you'll wind up expanding this node d plus 1 times. And these nodes will be expanded d times. These nodes will be expanded d minus 1 times if the optimal solution is at depth d. Even though that is true, it turns out, as you know from your life with binary search trees, the evil lurks at the bottom. The maximum number of nodes, basically from level L to level L plus 1, the number of nodes double. So really, expanding the interior nodes more times is a wash mostly, as long as everything is actually at the bottom. Like binary search trees, it's double. For B search, B branching factor search case, it's B times more at the bottom. So it turns out iterative deep learning depth first search actually winds up giving you both optimality and completeness. And it only has a little more time, it takes only a little more time than normal depth first search. In particular, you can show that the ratio is d plus 1 by d minus 1. Kind of nice. So we started from what looked like a very simple model. We are not even looking at much of a knowledge of the problem. And still, we are able to actually just see that the graph search algorithms have very different trade-offs. The next thing we look at in the case of search is, instead of just queues and stacks, you talk about prioritized queues. You guys talked about prioritized queues. Now it turns out prioritized queues essentially can combine both. By just changing the priorities of the nodes, you'll wind up shifting their position in the queue. And the question in the prioritized queues would be, how do you assign priorities for the nodes? And that brings us partly towards informed search, which is where A-star search comes in. Okay, now before I actually go into more details of that by flashing some slides, let me tell you what happens after atomic models. This is all atomic models, where essentially all you care about in atomic models is you have a child generator function which takes a state and gives the children states. And you have a goal test function which takes a state and says yes or no. And that's it. And all the action in terms of search algorithms is, what data structure do you use to keep the children node, the nodes to be expanded. So the nodes that have been generated, that means you know they exist, and so you have to expand them at some point of time by giving them to the children node, children node generator. In what order do you do it? That's the only difference. Okay. Now then, when we get to propositional or factored, we'll start saying the states are not just indivisible units, they have features. So for example, I can say, well, my state in this room, for example, contains, you know, I can talk about, so if I, for example, talk about the state of this table, right, I can say, you know, right now, I have my, whatever the, my pointer on top of my soda can. That's a particular feature of the state, okay? And then if I put it here, my pointer is on the table, my soda can is on the table, but the pointer is not on top of the soda can. So I am essentially providing structure by describing the state in terms of state variables, okay? And when you have state variables, basically, if you such say you have, we'll talk about models called propositional logic. Those of you who know Boolean algebra, propositional logic, you know, if you have n propositions which can be true or false, then you, in essence, you can distinguish between how many different words. If you have n propositions that can be true or false, how many different configurations can you have? 2 to the power n. So the interesting thing then would be that when I have states, when I have these propositional models, essentially rather than talk about 2 power n states, I talk about n state variables. So it's compactness. You now are able to reason about 2 power n states indirectly through just n propositions that define them. It's not that the complexity goes away, it is that the representations can be compact now. So you don't need as much of a space in your mind, in your brain to put them. Okay? So that would be propositional. As you go atomic, propositional, relational, by the time you get to relational, you will say, not only do you have propositions that can be true and false, really the world, so here your definition of how the world is made up of, what's called the ontological commitment, big name. So your ontological commitment in atomic worlds is that the world has indivisible states. That's it. Your ontological commitment in the propositional worlds is that the world is made up of statements that are either true or false. Your ontological commitment when you get to relational world is you will say the world is made up of objects and relations between objects. And if you start seeing this is some kind of a machine language and this is some kind of higher level language which is object oriented, you are not on the wrong track. Relational representations essentially are thinking about objects and the relations between them. From the logic perspective, this one is propositional logic, this turns out to be predicate logic, where you have predicates over terms, and then you can talk about, so once again, relational representations tend to be even more compact than the propositional representations. So really the view of thinking of these as this is machine language and this is higher level languages is actually on the right track. It only fails when you go even further and go to first